Welcome to San Joaquin Spotlight, a public affairs program featuring conversations about life in the central San Joaquin Valley. This program is brought to you in partnership between KFSR 90.7 FM and CMAQ Fresno. Today, we celebrate episode 99 of the partnership between 90.7 FM, KFSR Fresno, and CMAQ, the Community Media Access Collaborative, Comcast 93 and AT&T 99. We're going to take a trip down memory lane and show you some past interviews. I'm your host, Sevog Tatiosi, and today we're in Fresno, California. The crew of San Joaquin Spotlight is out and about at the Omni Festival at the Valdez Hall. Let's go inside and take a look at some cool stuff. We are back with Jaisal and this fantastic car. Jaisal, how you doing?
I'm fine, thank you. How are you doing?
So you own this car?
Yes, I do.
So talk a little bit about the pictures and what's going on in the car.
This is a 2003 Infiniti G35. We do SEMA, car shows, a lot of charity events, and this is a culmination of about 4 years worth of work.
So what exactly did you do to this car? Because you've got pictures, you've got the interior is all fixed up.
I've done just about every possible modification you could do to this vehicle. We have anime figurines inside. The art style is called Itasha. It stands for painful car. It's a trend that's in Japan, and we're the first car club here in America to bring it. We're called Team Love Hate. It's another car. We have a car outside. We've been doing this since 2008, and yeah, we come out to cons and, you know, have a good time.
What got you to do this to the car? Because Infiniti is a nice car, but you've made it nicer.
I think it's just one of those things where you just keep modding your car and you keep going, you keep going. We do the big show in Las Vegas every year, SEMA, so yeah, it's where the best of the best cars go, and I just wanted to keep pushing the car until I thought she'd be done.
By the way, how many cars have a video game playing device in the trunk? Because this is pretty cool.
I think a handful in America. I've seen a Veloster that has one, and I think that's it. This is a unique build. The company helped me put this together. It was really nice. So, yeah, it's pretty much one of a kind. Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Jaisal.
Oh, you're welcome. Thanks.
Let's take a look inside this vehicle. So who wants to start and talk about the water issue that led to this documentary?
Well, since I'm the farmer and I'm the one that is experiencing the issues with the water, I'll begin. Basically what we have is we have had shortages of water that have been based on not only hydrology, but also based on regulations that that regulate the water that comes south from the Delta. Now, our water comes from Northern California, Mount Shasta, and it comes down the Sacramento River, comes to the Delta. It has to cross the Delta to where our pumps are, and then from there, the pumps run it down to us through canals and through San Luis Reservoir. There's a problem in the Delta with endangered species, and oftentimes our pumps are restricted because of the what they call fish actions in the Delta. And so some years we're restricted to 80%, 40%. This year we happen to be at 20%, which is pretty severe.
20%?
20% of our supply, that's all we got this year.
What does that mean to the local economy when only 20% of the water is on?
Well, that means that if you don't have water, you're gonna leave some land unplanted. And when you leave land unplanted, there's going to be less dollars brought in, farm dollars, there's going to be less jobs for people, farm workers, and of course there's going to be less supplies and materials bought from the local economy. So it affects everybody.
Today we're going to be talking about a chorus, a community chorus, with our guest Alan Peters. Alan, welcome to the program.
It's a real pleasure to be here again.
Welcome back, I
That's
should
right.
say. You know, it's a pleasure having you here because you enlighten us a lot about what's going on in the community in terms of a chorus. Now, welcome back again.
It's great to be here. Choral music is part of my life, an important part of my life, so I love to talk about it.
How would you define choral music? Let's say that I've never heard about what choral music is. What would be your definition?
It's music that requires a group of people singing in harmony or in unison, but largely a group of men and women in various voices, low, high, medium, that make melodies that have been written for a chorus. There are many, many choral works, and choirs have always been an important part of human culture.
Do you think that a chorus is better when it has both men and women? I mean, I know that there are some choruses that have only men, and there are some that only have women, and they're great. In your opinion, when you mix the two, what do you think?
There's great music for every combination. In fact, in the English tradition, and even here in the United States, instead of having women in choirs, there are a good number of choirs that are men and boys.
Interesting.
And the boys sing the soprano and alto parts, and the men sing the tenor and bass. And there are also men that sing alto, and many of you have heard some of the male choruses like Chanticleer or the King's Singers, and they've got men that sing all four parts.
Talk about the difference between a chorus and an opera. Both are live, aren't they?
Right. Now, choral music can be in an opera. There are choirs that sing in operas, and there's a lot of choral music in operas. But operas generally are dramatic productions that include not only the singing, but the acting out of the story. So that an opera, you'll have a story told, and people take parts, and they will, many times with a solo or duets or trios, they'll just tell the story by singing, with the chorus coming in whenever it's appropriate, acting like a crowd or a group of people. But an opera generally tells a story, while a choral work can do that. And there are some, like they call them oratorios, which are Bible stories usually that are told by choirs with soloists. But choirs usually sing works that are more poetic, and they're not necessarily telling a story. They may just be recitals of scripture. A lot of churches have choirs that sing anthems or scriptures that become a part of the worship service.
Can you tell a story in this kind of music?
Oh, yes. Especially when you have people singing roles, just like in a play, you have people speaking roles. You can just transfer the idea of a play on the stage into an opera by making it musical instead of just a spoken word. Now, you see on Broadway, you have musicals there which are sort of similar to operas because they're stories that are told in music, but it's a much more popular kind of an approach, and people hum the melodies. In olden times, people hummed the melodies of operas that they heard, just like we hum melodies out of Annie Get Your Gun or some of the other Broadway musicals that we see.
We're going to be talking about the Bridge Youth Program. It's out of Fresno City College, but the employer or organization that covers it is ResCare Workforce Services. We have Rodney Casillas. Welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me.
Let's talk a little bit about this program. It's we call it the Bridge Youth Program, right?
It's actually called the Fresno County Bridge Program. It's a collaboration between ResCare Workforce Services along with Fresno City College and Fresno County.
So your role in that is what?
As my title indicates, I'm the leader. For what that means is specifically I lead our youth. We work with approximately 40 youth every school year, getting them going at Fresno City College. And when I say we get them going, we do every step or assist them with every step from bringing them into the program, helping them with their Fresno City College application, financial aid. We do placement testing in our office, so sometimes they don't have to wait in those long lines at Fresno City College in the heat. And then once that's set, we actually set them up in their classes. We assign them, they have priority seating in our classes, which is four subjects. And then they also get their own Fresno City College counselor, and they get me, access to me, Bridge Youth Leader, and I'm like their mentor, their assistant, their tutor, everything throughout the entire semester. It's a one semester program. So at the end of the semester, we kind of set them going on three different paths. One path is to remain in education, help them continue with that. We do that by way of setting them up with a student education plan so they can know exactly what classes they need to take for the next 2 years to graduate on time. Another option that they have is they do vocational training, so they can select something that's a little bit more short term. Sometimes that college thing's a little long distance.
Out there, yeah.
Sure, it's a long dedicated path, but some choose a little bit shorter path, vocational training. And we have a ton of variety of different vocational trainings that we're able to offer: medical assistant, culinary arts, dental assistant, just a long list, security guard training, things like that. The third option that we can offer them at the end of that semester is employment, full-time permanent employment. We assist them in that path. So at the end of that semester, they get to make that choice for themselves in terms of what they want to do with the program.
Where do the youth come from? I mean, do they voluntarily enroll themselves, or do parents enroll them?
It's a completely voluntary program. So a lot of our youth, believe it or not, come from word of mouth. They come from the community, from Fresno County. We work with a lot of foster youth. Initially, this program was designed to assist specifically foster youth. We have opened it up a little bit to non-foster, but the idea, the plan is still to work specifically with foster youth through this program. The foster community is definitely a population of the community that is very much in need of assistance. So this program was designed with them in mind. A lot of our foster youth, when they're aging out at 18, for a long time didn't have assistance, didn't have even a home to stay in. Pretty much a lot of foster families would tell them, you're booted, you're out. So with this, when this program came along, that was one of our biggest challenges, was helping them with that step. Fortunately, through the assistance of Assembly Bill 12 here in California, a lot of foster youth are now able to stay in care until the age of 21.
So
that's huge. That's gigantic. Because now foster youth can stay in care. They don't have to worry about having a roof over their head or food in their mouths. They can focus completely on their education or vocational training or employment.
Do we have a big problem with need for foster assistance or
Absolutely.
Even foster care homes? I mean, you know, there's a lot of people who may not think about that aspect. You know, it's a total different thing. But you deal directly with these foster youth. Would you say that there's a need there?
Oh, yes, there's definitely a need, specifically because the reality is that foster youth is a tough population. They've come from a very varied background. Sometimes there's a lot of abuse, neglect, things like that. They come from families that have dealt with drug abuse and alcohol abuse. So their situation, sometimes the issues they have to deal with are pretty heavy. So having a stable home for them can sometimes prove a challenge. They don't always agree with the family that they're staying with. They don't always see eye to eye. So it's up to the county to try to find a new placement for them. So it's important that they're able to establish a proper home, or at least somewhere where they're comfortable and can focus on their education and their lives.
What are some of the reasons someone would go into foster care? And the reason I ask you the question is because we have this kind of generalized stereotype that if someone is in foster care, they're there because they're bad, they did something horrible, they're doing drugs, and they can't get along with their parents.
Right, that's a stereotypical idea that we hear all the time. The reality is that a lot of foster youth are in care because mom and dad were doing things that they weren't supposed to be doing, and the children have been taken out by CPS and then relocated to group homes or foster homes, things like that. So sometimes it's not their fault at all. In fact, most of the time I would say it's not their fault. It's in things that are going on in their lives that they have no control over. Sometimes it's because parents gave up on them at an early age and left them for adoption or left them up to the county.
Is that happening a lot, would you say, with parents? Are they, I mean, you know, we hear the stereotype that, you know, sometimes parents will have the kids and then just let them go and get raised by the neighbor.
Well, I can't say a whole lot in terms of if we see that happening a lot. I work with a very small population and percentage-wise in terms of all the Fresno County foster youth, so I really couldn't speak a whole lot about that, but I can say that it has happened and we've seen it happen.
In the studio, we have Casey Lemonsky. She is with the Lyles Center for Entrepreneurship. Casey, welcome to the program.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Lyles Center, what kind of organization is that?
Oh, wow. Well, we have lots of really awesome things that happen at the Lyles Center. But the Lyles Center for Innovation Entrepreneurship is on Fresno State's campus. We have entrepreneurship education for preschool through 12th grade. And then we have some community...
Preschool, I got to stop you there. Sorry for the interruption.
That's all right, it's okay. Preschool, yes.
What are you teaching preschool kids about entrepreneurship?
Okay, so what we teach them from the preschool through the sixth grade level is we really focus a lot on innovation and hands-on activities, teaching them science, math, technology, leadership, communication. So really that foundation to get them started to be successful in the future. We do have some things that we do with them where they get to invent a toy or something, and then they get to name the toy, and they get to price the toy, things along those lines. So we give them a little taste of the business aspect of them with that. But our preschool through sixth grade stuff is really a lot of hands-on innovation stuff that we do with them to learn different ways of doing things.
So this may be off-topic question, but do you believe that taking a child at kindergarten or preschool, they can learn to be entrepreneurs at that age?
Oh, I think that there's you can learn to be an entrepreneur, but I think being an entrepreneur is something deep inside. But we think that we give all of these kids an opportunity to try it. I mean, it's kind of like when mom was feeding you peas. You got to try it before you say no to it. But giving them the foundations for the innovation stuff, to build stuff with their hands, to learn the science behind, you know, when you drop a Mentos in the Diet Coke and it explodes everywhere, how does all that stuff work? It just really helps them round them out. So
it's a big group that you just mentioned. I mean, you're doing some pretty cool things with a lot of students, it sounds like. So who teaches them? I mean, who's the one that actually teaches these kids?
It depends on the program. Our young kids, it's called our Kids Invent program, and we have staff that is trained in the program and the curriculum to do it. We also will train the instructors at the schools, and then, you know, it could be a Sunday school. We'll train their teachers and their staff. So we have a couple options in that, whatever fits that organization's idea the best.
So let's say we have a school, a small charter school or community school, mm-hmm. or general large school, and a teacher comes to you and says, you know what, I've got this pack of kindergartens, I want them to learn whatever you're going to teach them. Do you teach them?
We have that option. If they decide to go with that route, we can come in, and we're actually working on stuff like right now with one of the districts on that, where we train their teacher, because the teacher in the classroom, and then we come in and help facilitate it. So we have some options on how to do it in the classroom.
We were talking off camera about some cool projects some of your students have done. Talk about one of the projects that they've done.
So within the Lyle Center for Innovation Entrepreneurship, we've got a high school level entrepreneurship program, and then we have our community college level, and then we obviously have Fresno State's entrepreneurship program. And one of our success stories on a student starting a business and being successful with it, she's from Reedley, she started the program, graduated from Fresno State with her entrepreneurship, and has a company that is called The Caramel Company. Miss Tiffany Lowe is doing that, and she took her mom's caramel recipe and turned it into this business.
Don't you love that?
I do, and I have to tell you, they're the most addicting caramels I've ever had in my entire life. She sent me a message this morning and said, I have an extra pound of this specific type, are you interested? I said, heck yeah, bring it on over, I'll buy the whole pound. But they're very addicting, and it's that whole kind of idea that you start something with just an idea and mom's recipe, and it turns into this big thing.
Today we are going to be talking about 90.7 FM, KFSR Fresno. Yes, the radio station that broadcasts out of Fresno State, but it's not only a Fresno State radio station. Here's Mike Stevens, the station manager.
How you doing?
I'm doing great, Mike. I almost called your last name Station instead
of
Mike Stevens.
You could call me Jeff. Some people have.
Jeff. So KFSR, tell us a little bit about this state studio.
The anomaly that is KFSR. Well, you know, you've been there quite some time too. You know, so we could go back and forth, you know, exchanging stories on, you know, what it means to us, right?
It's a great secret in radio.
It really, really is, and it's been around for what? 40 years when it was like a closed carrier just to the dorms, and now it's still not up at full capacity as far as like wattage is concerned. But the secret is that we're at Fresno State, been at Fresno State all this time. We're licensed by the university, and we're at a lower power. We could actually get a higher power, which would be kind of neat. But yeah, man, we're the only jazz radio station in town. We can hang our hat on that. We also do a ton of blues on the weekends.
But, you know, before we get too far, now, this show broadcasts on KFSR, and when I tell people that, they say, oh, so only the college can hear you. But that's not true, because I've been driving east to the mountains and I hear us. So tell us a little bit about how far our reach is.
Okay, the coverage is, is Fresno metro area, right? So it's Fresno, Clovis, metro. If you go up to the mountains, like say Shaver, clear as day, because it's the higher point. And we've got another disc jockey who Jeff Parker, who does the jazz show on, I think it's like Tuesdays. And he's got a cabin up in the mountains and he can get as clear as day. So it's a directional type of thing. You know, if you're going along the valley, like the valley proper, let's say, it's going to depreciate only because you have more signals that'll interfere with it. But yeah, we reach a long way.
And this show, San Joaquin Spotlight, mm-hmm. has been on since 2006. So, I mean, there are shows with a lot of history on that station.
Yeah, like you were on the Hayush show.
Hayush has been on the air for a long time as well.
Since the early 90s. So
why would people want to listen to KFSR? I mean, when you're out there and you say, hey, I'm the station manager of 90.7 FM, KFSR Fresno, if I asked you, why should I listen to you, what would your answer be?
We're the radio station that's doing something no other radio station does. I come from a background of commercial radio and program director. Julie Logan, I think combined, we're really old if we combine the two. So we've got the management of commercial radio behind something that's a nonprofit. So we're just making it a different avenue source for listenership.
Radio, I mean, you and Julie Logan, who you just mentioned, you've been in radio for a very long time.
Yeah.
This industry is changing, or are we done seeing changes in this industry?
You know what? I think what's going to happen, the biggest change is people are going to be coming back to radio, right? So that's where we come in, because we've got unique programming that nobody else is doing, and we don't have the clutter of all the commercials as well. We do have, you know, announcements, messages for nonprofits, underwriting messages, but we're nowhere close to sounding like a commercial radio station. So to answer the question of what will people find at the radio station is a unique blend of passionate DJs who really know their music and craft.
Today we're going to talk about one of my favorite subjects, that's flying. Yes, flying in the air with... We have two individuals here. We have Doug Betts, who is wearing a different hat today. Doug is on the crew here at San Joaquin Spotlight, but he's also a pilot, and you're also the president of the Bill Smiley Aviation Center, correct?
Yes, that's right.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much.
I should say welcome back to the show.
Yeah.
And then we have Michael Murphy, and this young man impresses me because he's 14 years old, and in a little bit we're going to watch him behind a real airplane, in the cockpit, flying the airplane. Michael, welcome to the program.
Thanks for having me.
So this is a unique partnership we've got going over here. How did this partnership come about?
Well, Miko has quite an extensive background with his aviation interest, and that interest grew to such a point that he came out to Chandler Airport trying to take lessons.
Can I stop you there and say aviation interest? I mean, how old are you?
14.
14 years old, and he has an aviation interest, and he's in the airplane. Is this unusual? I mean, do kids at this age, well, young men at this age, want to get behind the plane and actually do it?
Well, this is not 14 in an aviation interest. This is 14 and has had an aviation interest for years.
Oh, okay.
This is not new for him.
When did you want to get involved in this?
Since I was a baby, I guess. That's when I just moved to Fresno, and I was able to see the airplanes fly over my house.
So you're by Chandler Airport, and you're seeing these planes, and what are you thinking?
I just always ask, what kind of plane is that? And I wonder what they're doing in there, and I want to be up there with that person.
When did you take it to the next level? Because, you know, young, I was young too, and, you know, we have dreams, and we want to do all these things, and sometimes what happens is life gets in the way and you don't follow those dreams, but you're actually doing it.
Yeah.
How?
Well, I was about 10 and I just always think like I have so many years until I can start flying the real airplanes. And then I just looked into it and finally I was able to get in. And went out for my first lesson, and that went by smooth. I went by for a second one, and I couldn't do it because I didn't have an ID. So,
Doug, he's so calm. I mean, you know, he's so calm, and the way he talks is, you know, it's like a surgeon, little by little, you know. What do you have to say about him? How impressed are you with this young man?
Well, I'm very impressed, and it's to give a little piece of where it comes from. I think part of his background is flight simulator on his computer, but most people would go to a computer and just kind of fly around. He didn't do that. He actually learned the procedure for flying airplanes, and he actually interacts with other people over the internet and flies with air traffic controllers simulated over the internet.
So he before he actually got into the airplane, he did his homework.
That's right.
Your aviation center that you're president of, can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah, the Bill Smiley Aviation Center out at Sierra Sky Park Airport. That's actually a project name. Our corporate name is EAA Chapter 376. So we're part of the Experimental Aircraft Association. Bill Smiley created Sierra Sky Park in 1946. It was the first residential airpark in the world. And we use that unique story to encourage kids when they come out to us for a free airplane flight. We point out when Bill Smiley started telling people he wanted to create this place where airplanes can land on the runway, taxi out to their house, and park at their house, people told him he was crazy. You can't do that. So he had the passion, the desire to do it. So we encourage kids to find a passion, a desire, something to drive their lives. And then we also use the education piece that to be a pilot, you have to know a lot of different subject areas. Therefore, all of these subject areas that you're learning in school are important. So don't just stay in school, but do well in school.
That's all for this edition of San Joaquin Spotlight, episode 99, A Trip Down Memory Lane. Tune in next week to a new edition.